Manager, Captain Andrews. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Ron.
Hi, sir. We do want to get your assessment on how airport authorities handled the situation first. Do you think the Shaman plane could have been cleared from the airport faster than a day and a half, given the situation at that time?
Well, first of all, I think what caused all this, the accident, and what caused the accident would have to be determined by the regulatory body, which now, from the partial reports I've been reading and hearing in the radio and TV, it appears that there may have been a fuel problem as far as the pilot was concerned, because he had made holding and he had made one missed approach. Now, assuming that on his final approach he was already low on fuel, he was permitted to land no matter what. Mm-hmm. So this is something that we'll have to be looked into more thoroughly by CAAP. I say this because I used to be the chairman of the Aircraft Accident Investigation Board of the CAAP during my time. And based on the reports, the left engine was sheared off. And if this did happen, there should have been some fuel leak if there was still fuel in the tanks. And I have not heard of any passenger or anyone making comments about fuel fumes coming out of the airplane. Mm-hmm. Now, as far as the reaction of the NAIA authorities are concerned, I think based on the incident, there are several things that has to be considered. First of all, once an accident does occur, nobody can go near the aircraft, touch any equipment, until the aircraft's investigation board has done a complete check. This will take probably a few hours to do. And only after this can equipment to extricate the aircraft or remove the aircraft can be started. Based on this, plus the time it will take to remove all the debris from the aircraft, it should there should be a minimum time of about 12 hours given this. Now, the first opening that was reported on radio was the airport to be opening at 8 o'clock. Mm-hmm. Now, if there were passengers in the airport, you would say, what's another 8 hours? The airport's going to open up again. Again, the passengers departing after the 8 hours were proceeding again to the airport. So what did we have? Right. Compilation of all passengers departing and leaving. No? So this compounded the problems of the airport. So there should have been, let's say, there should be lessons learned at this time for in the NAIA management to be able to determine good timings. As an afterthought, if the initial report would have said that the main runway 2406 was no longer operational, airlines could have planned of all long-range flights, which would require the bigger runway, could have been canceled already immediately, and passengers could have been informed. That's one. Next, we must remember that Manila only has one runway. The other runway is non-operational. Consider it non-operational. So, this airport will always be subject to incidents or accidents of this kind. It's something they have to live with. The only remedy for this is Melbourne Airport would have two parallel runways, independent parallel runways, wherein these types of affairs would no longer happen.
Captain Andrews, why is the other runway non-operational?
Well, first of all, this is almost perpendicular to the big runway. Mm-hmm. Now, during the time of other presidents, except this president, this runway departing on the northwest would transgress on the no-fly zone of Malacañan. Now, because this president has already cleared the area, airplanes can depart here, but also subject to wind conditions, because there's only one landing runway here, landing out towards the southeast. So when the wind conditions prevent landing from this, the airport is totally unusable.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying that, Captain Andrews. Now, with the manner the Shamin plane was lifted and taken out of the NAIA runway, was the use of a crane the proper way or the best way the Shamin plane could have been taken out?
Well, I believe that the NAIA has got the basic equipment, first of all, to lift the plane up. There's a use of airbags wherein it's lifted, and then braces are placed, straps around the aircraft to lift it up so that the trolley could be placed under. Now, they said that the the area was wet and muddy, and everything was getting stuck down. Now, this could be expected because you don't get an aircraft getting out the runway unless there was heavy rain involved. And the crane, I believe, the first crane they used was not enough to lift the airplane up. So they had to procure another crane. Now, there are also certain talks that the AIA should be equipped with a crane of its own capable of holding an aircraft up.
What do you think of that?
Now, well, I would really not advise this. What I would advise is for NAIA to have contacts with contractors having this capability and availability within a set time frame. Because if you keep this equipment at NAIA, the expense involved in just maintaining it for an eventual use, which may happen 10 years from now, will not be worth it.
Right. Okay.
Now, there's also,
go ahead, sir,
a question that has been coming up, wherein they were being questioned whether they were trying to salvage the plane, the aircraft, rather than expedite the removal of the aircraft. I think this was really explained well by the manager of NAIA, wherein the first movement of an aircraft will be the responsibility of the airline. Now, the airline delegated this responsibility to NAIA because they had no way of coming here and helping out. Now, I believe that there should be a certain time frame set, because right now there's none. Certain time frame set wherein, if the aircraft is not capable of being removed from that area within a certain time, extraordinary measures should be taken, like bulldozering it out of the area.
Right. Okay, Captain John Andrews, former CAAP Deputy Director, thank you very much for clarifying a lot of stuff for us, and thank you very much for talking to us, sir.
Thank you, Bill.